Hello everyone, welcome to my channel Biology Addiction. Here's the second part of my previous video, that is the uptake mechanism of nutrients by microorganisms. The link of my previous videos are given in the description box. You can check those. So let's get addicted together with the beauty of biology and never stop learning. If you are new here, please subscribe to my channel and hit the bell icon so that you never miss any updates of this channel. The first step in nutrient use is their uptake by the microbial cell. Microbes can only take in dissolved molecules. Uptake mechanisms must be specific, that is, the necessary substances and not others must be acquired. So microbes must be able to transport nutrients from dilute solutions into the cell against a concentration gradient. Finally, the nutrient molecules must pass through a selectively permeable plasma membrane that prevents the free passage of most substances. Microorganisms make use of several different transport mechanisms. Members of bacteria and archaea use facilitated diffusion, active transport, and group translocation, and eukaryotic microorganisms use facilitated diffusion, active transport, and endocytosis. These are the uptake mechanisms of nutrients by microorganisms: passive diffusion, facilitated diffusion, active transport, group translocation, and iron uptake. So starting from the passive diffusion or simple diffusion, it is the process by which molecules move from a region of higher concentration to one of lower concentration. Cells must be able to take up nutrients from their environment, but it is also imperative that the plasma membrane be impermeable to most substances. If the membrane were freely permeable to all substances, then the cell would not be able to concentrate needed nutrients in the cytoplasm. It also would not be able to maintain other important concentration differences across the membrane. However, some metabolic processes require that certain gases easily diffuse across the plasma membrane, including oxygen and carbon dioxide, H2O, which are all able to enter the cell by passive diffusion. H2O allows the cell to adjust to differences in solute concentration. Moving to the facilitated diffusion, the rate of diffusion across selectively permeable membrane is greatly increased by using carrier proteins named permeases, which are embedded in the plasma membrane and create channels through which substance passes. This type of diffusion is called facilitated diffusion. Some permeases are related to the major intrinsic protein or MIP family of proteins. They help in the diffusion of small polar molecules. They are observed in all organisms. Two most widespread MIP channels in bacteria are aquaporins, which transport water, and glycerol facilitators, which aid glycerol diffusion. In facilitated diffusion, a concentration gradient spanning the membrane drives the movement of molecules, and no metabolic energy input is required. If the concentration gradient disappears, net inward movement ceases. The gradient can be maintained by transforming the transported nutrient to another compound. Eukaryotic cells can maintain a gradient by moving the nutrient to another membranous compartment. After the solid molecules binds to the outside, the carrier protein is thought to change conformation and release the molecule on the cell interior. The carrier subsequently changes back to its original conformation and is ready to pick up another molecule, can enter the cell in response to its concentration gradient. Remember that this mechanism is driven by concentration gradients and therefore is reversible. If the solute's concentration is greater inside the cell, it will move outward. However, because the cell metabolizes nutrients upon entry, influx is favored. Then active transport. It is the transport of solute molecules to higher concentration, that is against concentration gradient, with the input of metabolic energy. Active transport is also characterized by the carrier saturation effect at high solute concentrations. Active transport proteins are divided into two types. They are primary transporters and secondary transporters. Primary active transporters use the energy provided by ATP hydrolysis to move substances against a concentration gradient. In case of secondary active transporters, that couples the potential energy of ion gradients to transport of substances. Primary active transporters. The major primary active transporters are ATP binding cassette transporters or ABC transporters, which are observed in bacteria, archaea and eukaryotes. Some are used for import of substances in case of bacteria and archaea, and others are used for export of substances found in all three domains of life. ABC transporters consist of two hydrophobic membrane spanning domains associated on their cytoplasmic surfaces with two ATP binding domains. The membrane spanning domains form a pore in the membrane, and the ATP binding domains bind and hydrolyze ATP to drive uptake. ABC transporters employ substrate binding proteins, which are located in the periplasmic space of gram-negative bacteria, and they are attached to membrane lipids on the external face of the plasma membrane in case of gram-positive bacteria. These proteins bind the molecules to be transported and then interact with the transporter proteins to move the molecule into the cell. Because a single molecule is transported, this is termed as uniport transport. In case of gram-negative bacteria, there is an outer membrane in addition to the plasma membrane. So substances entering gram-negative bacteria must pass through the outer membrane before ABC transporters and other active transport systems can take action. When the substance is small, a porin protein such as OMPF, which is an outer membrane protein, can be used. The transport of larger molecules like vitamin B12 needs the use of specialized high affinity outer membrane receptors. That function is association with specific transporters in the plasma membrane. Then secondary active transporters. These include the major facilitator superfamily proteins or MFS proteins, which use ion gradients, some of which are created by microbes during their metabolic processes. For instance, in case of bacteria and archaea, electron transport during energy conserving processes generates a proton gradient that can be used in secondary active transport. For example, in case of E. coli, the lactase permease is a single protein that transports a lactose molecule inward as a proton simultaneously enters the cell. The proton is moving down a proton gradient and the energy released drives solute transport. Such link transport of two substances in the same direction is called symport. The transport proteins has outward and inward facing conformations. When lactose and a proton bind to separate sites on the outward-facing conformations, the protein changes to its inward-facing conformation. Then the sugar and proton are released into the cytoplasm. A proton gradient also can power secondary active transport indirectly, often through the formation of a sodium ion gradient. For example, an E. coli sodium transport system pumps sodium outward in response to the inward movement of protons. Such link transport, in which the transported substances move in opposite directions, is termed antiport. The sodium gradient generated by this proton antiport system drives the uptake of sugars and amino acids. It is thought that sodium ion attaches to a carrier protein, causing it to change shape. The carrier then binds the sugar and amino acids tightly and orients its binding sites towards the cell interior. Because of the low intracellular sodium concentration, the sodium ion dissociates from the carrier and the other molecules follows. Then group translocation. It is a energy dependent transport which chemically modifies the molecule as it is brought into the cell. Usually the group translocation system found in bacteria is the phosphoenol pyruvate sugar phosphotransferase system, or PTS, which transports a variety of sugars while phosphorylating them using phosphoenol pyruvate as the phosphate donor. In transfer of phosphate from PEP to the incoming molecule involves several proteins and is an example of phosphorelase system. In E. coli and Salmonella, the PTS consisting of two enzymes and a low molecular weight heat stable protein, or HPR. A phosphate is transferred from PEP to enzyme 2 with the help of enzyme 1 and HPR. Then a sugar molecule is phosphorylated as it is carried across the membrane by enzyme 2. Enzyme 2 transfers only specific sugars and varies with the PTS, whereas enzyme 1 and HPR are common to all PTS. Then the last one is iron uptake. All microorganisms require iron for use in cytochromes and many enzymes. Iron uptake becomes difficult by the extreme insolubility of ferric iron and its derivatives, which leaves little free iron available for transport. To overcome this difficulty, many bacteria and fungi secrete siderophores, which are low molecular weight organic molecules that bind ferric iron and supply it to the cell. For example of siderophores are ferrichrome, produced by many fungi, and enterobacterium, formed by E. coli. Microorganisms secrete siderophores when iron is scarce in the medium. At first, iron siderophores complex has reached the cell surface. It binds to a siderophore receptor protein. Then either the iron is reached to the cell directly, or the whole iron siderophore complex is transported inside by an ABC transporters. And this picture shows in case of gram-positive bacteria, iron uptake. That's all about the uptake mechanism of nutrients by microorganisms. The PDF of my overall lecture is given in the description box. Hope you like it. Hope this is informative to you. Please subscribe my channel and hit the bell icon. And if you like this video, please like, share and comment on this. Thank you.